Hi, everybody, and welcome to Otakusphere Weekly, episode 21. We are old enough to drink. I don't drink
Which I am
personally.
doing.
Yeah, I don't drink personally, so it's completely wasted on me. But if everybody out there listening wants to get hammered, you know, it's legal now because we're a legally drinking podcast. This makes no sense. It made more sense in my head.
I would have. I would have grabbed something to drink if we would have went through this in advance. But go on.
Well, it's okay. Now you know you can drink from this week on, and every subsequent week. Don't become an alcoholic though. That would be bad. Okay, I'm Karen, and with me tonight are Sal.
Good evening.
Life Song.
Hello.
And LB.
Yo yo.
We have plenty of current fall season anime to discuss tonight, but I think LB went back and watched some stuff from summer that I thought we might want to talk about. Now, you caught up on Sweetness and Lightning?
Not all of it. I'm about halfway through it. I started watching it because Sal and Life Song both recommended it to me. It's very cute. It's very sweet. I'm enjoying it a ton, though. It's one of those series that I have to eat before I watch it.
Oh, otherwise, hell yeah.
By the time I finish an episode, I'm starving. So, yeah, it's one of those series where I have to watch it on a full stomach.
I don't know. I really enjoyed it, but I do feel like there's an element of, you know, once you've seen one episode, you've kind of seen them all. It's like Tsumugi's a little upset, and then Daddy and her friend make food, and then she's like, yay, delicious food, and then that's the end of the episode.
Yeah, I have a confession. I actually haven't finished it. I think I got like halfway through. I will eventually finish it, but it's one of those shows where it's like every once in a while I'll pull up an episode and I'll love it. But
you don't feel compelled to see the next episode.
No, it's like another dose of the same thing. So it really is an anime I'm just going to spread out over a long time.
Yeah. Actually, you know what anime has kind of been like that for me, even though it shouldn't be? Mayu, you know, the one from a couple of years ago is actually about like economics. I like it a lot, but just for some reason, I think I've been like in between episodes for about 2 months now.
Oh, is that the one with the demon queen?
Yeah, the demon queen, and then you think it's going to be like the hero fighting the demon lord, and then she gets there, and she's like, well, actually, let's talk about crop rotation.
Oh, by the way, like, was Lock Horizon by that same author or a different person?
Yes, that is the same. That is the author of Lock Horizon.
Oh, see, I didn't know that. I learned something new. Okay, in addition to Sweetness and Lightning, you're catching up on a few other shows, LB?
Yeah, I had kind of a rough week, or rough weeks, to be fair. So I've also been dipping back into Ask Class for I don't know how many times now, but I dipped back into that, so I'm about at the end of the first season, so I'm still kind of, you know, meandering my way through that. I've seen it enough times that I can, you know, just space it out and watch an episode here and there. And then I also started rewatching Date Alive because, you know, I just felt the need to watch Cheesy Harem Fair. And I can't remember if I ever watched a second season of that. So I went ahead and just turned it on and started over from season one. And yeah, I'm making my way through that a couple of episodes a night.
I don't know what Date Alive is. I've heard the name, and that's about as far as it goes.
It's very cheesy harem series about average teenage guy who lives in a world where spatial quakes happen. Basically, black holes kind of appear on the Earth and cause massive destruction, and he finds out that the cause of these spatial quakes are actually very pretty girls who are appearing from another world, and he is tasked with making these girls fall in love with him in order to calm them down and stop these spatial quakes from causing destruction.
So, kind of sounds like the world God only knows.
Sort of.
Similar, except that if he messes up, the Earth is going to end, pretty much.
Yeah.
Well, in the world God only knows, if he messes up, he gets decapitated.
He dies, but the like everyone else in the show, like he's got this whole spaceship of people that are giving him advice on what to say when he's wooing these spirits, and they're just throwing all kinds of dating advice at him the entire time, which is I think what made it the most fun for me when I watched it.
See, that sounds
kind of curious how the game is, because I think Date Alive was originally a game.
I think it's originally a light novel. There is
no,
a game.
I think it was a manga. I'm pretty sure it was a manga.
I think it's all of these, but I believe the original is a light novel.
Like, yeah, media, okay, or maybe a multimedia project?
I'm pretty sure it started as a light novel.
Yeah, started as a manga or a light novel, one or the other, and then it kind of branched out as it got
a yes, you're popular. Right, it was a light novel.
And you might be happy to know, I'm not 100% on this, but I saw people talking about a season 3 the other day.
Oh, that's cool.
Yep.
Oh, I think I know what it was like. It's because the PS3 game was announced first and then the anime, so that's why I see it. And then it was the fact that it was Compile Heart who made the game, so I thought it was a Compile Heart creation, considering that Tsunako, the artist behind Neptunia, was doing the art for all the Data Lives.
Yes, I believe that he does the art for the light novel, actually. So yes, I could see how you would get confused by that.
Is Data Live streaming anywhere, or is this something you had on disc?
Funimation.
Oh, it should be on... Yeah, that'll be said.
It's on Funimation. I assume it'll move to Crunchyroll, or has moved to Crunchyroll soon, or... Will soon or already is.
Okay, because that sounds like the kind of show that Wilson would want to watch one day when he's like, everyone at work is stupid and I can't handle life. I'll be like, watch Data Live!
Yeah, it's...
This is a good series for that, yes.
Yeah, it's very just lighthearted, easy to digest, and just something to turn on when, you know, the world sucks.
Not all of it's entirely lighthearted.
Well, okay, yeah.
For the most part. I mean, yeah,
for the most part.
Okay.
She's not lighthearted.
Before we...
She is best girl.
Yes, she is best girl.
Oh, if we start with the best girl arguments, come on, we'll be here all night.
Well, it's an argument, we agree. It was almost dangerous there for a moment, but now that I know LB and I are on the same page, everything's good.
Okay, we can move forward then. Is there any... Life Song, Sal, do you guys want to mention any other shows you're catching up on before we go ahead?
Let's see. I don't think I've actually watched anything old this week. I do have something interesting that you guys might find interesting from the Final Fantasy MMO. You guys have played the original FF game, FF1?
Long time ago.
There's this big dramatic reveal in one of the story sequences in FF14 where you find out these Warriors of Darkness that you're fighting are actually the original party from the original game.
That's creepy.
Wow.
Yeah, it was like this neat reveal. I'm like, wow, that'd be really cool if I actually played that.
FF1 is... There's a couple of Final Fantasy games that I've started and restarted several times and never beat, and FF1 is one of them. FF1 and FF5. I've played a lot of both of them and just never beat either of them. So, I'm kind of trying to process that. But, like... well, I guess you wouldn't really need to, like... worry about it being consistent with the first game, because they could have kind of be anything in the first game, so.
Yeah, they kind of hop universes, and there's some crazy, I mean, like, they turned FF and the universe into, like, one universe and combined them all and made this giant theme park. That's what the MMO is, so. Yeah. It doesn't really make sense, but it was still kind
of
cool.
Yeah, because from what I've seen, it's like a little bit of everything that's like a callback to previous games, like with some of the later recent updates.
Yeah, like one game, one time you'll be fighting a boss from FF7, the next it's FF5. You never know.
Hell, I saw that one time they added the Golden Saucer place from 7 in the 14 verse. The
Golden Saucer is in FF14.
I don't know. That, just hearing you say that, it makes me feel kind of sad, because I feel like if like my teenage self had heard that, I would have been like, oh my god, that's so amazing! But now I'm like just so numb to everything that Square Enix does. I'm like, that's nice.
I understand why you're numb. I'm a bad FF fan. I've only really enjoyed the MMOs. So.
Speaking of Final Fantasy, Karen, like I saw a buddy of mine kind of stream World of Final Fantasy. And that not only is it like a fun shout out to the classic FF games, it's like adorable as hell.
Well, I know it's adorable. It's just I don't really know if I'm excited for it or not. Just because like I feel like I've had it up to here with Square Enix doing their self-referential "How much do you love our Final Fantasy stuff?" Ha 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 games. I feel like it just doesn't work for me anymore. But I don't know. I don't actually know that much of a World of Final Fantasy, so.
Well,
you know,
there's a
really
demo
say.
Of it. There's a demo of it for both the PS4 and the Vita, if you ever want to give it, like, a shot to see how it syncs up with you.
Okay, I'll try the Vita demo, then. That sounds relevant to my interests. Always happy to have an excuse to fire up the Vita. Okay, one more thing I wanted to mention before we move on to fall season shows. Did anyone else bother to watch Shelter, the music video?
Nope.
I have not seen it yet.
I've been meaning to, but I hear that it's very emotional.
It sounds really cool, and I don't want to have it spoiled.
Okay, I was just going to say a few things for it, but if you want to watch it, we can talk about it next week.
I forgot about it, but now that you've reminded me, like, oh right, I really want to watch that. So
okay, So, we're going to move on right ahead then with Yuri on Ice Episode 3, and I have a confession to make. I didn't find the Eros program, like, as sexy as I think I was supposed to. Like, I liked Yuri giving his, like, come hither look at the beginning, but then he's skating, and I'm like, I'm not really feeling the sexiness so much. I don't know, maybe it's me. But other than that, I really enjoy the episode. You know,
yeah, I did too, actually. This is the episode that really gripped me, and it's like, I love this show. But also, I also kind of was in.
It was amazing how the trigger for Yuri to do Eros was actually Tonkatsu.
Yeah, oh, you stole my line, damn it.
Yes, it's like, it's funny because, you know, like, back in spring, we were watching DJ, you know, DJ Tonkatsu DJ Agataro. It was like Tonkatsu of DJing, and now we're back to Tonkatsu, both ice skating.
I need a crossover.
Yes.
The world just revolves around Tonkatsu.
Yes.
As it should.
Like, yeah. Seriously, like I said, it should be a crossover with Agataro DJing some music, and then Yuri's, like, ice skating to the music.
I do have one thing to say about the animation quality, and I thought it was interesting that they put, it seemed like they put a lot more effort and finesse into the first Yuri's scene, as opposed to the second. I don't know, maybe they ran out of time or something, but they were like, I could see the in-between scenes a lot where they you look at his face and you're like, oh, they didn't finish that. And with the first one, it was like, oh, wow, this is gorgeous.
I seem to remember thinking
really
that...
kind of stood out to me.
Yeah, I seem to remember thinking that they showed more of Yurio's routine, of Russian Yuri, but I'm not... I don't know, maybe they ran out of time, but I don't know what to make of the animation quality and the skating scenes. I kind of go back and forth on it.
I don't know. It was just kind of odd to me because it felt weird that they would that the first one looked so good and then the second one it's like wouldn't it have been more important to make his look good?
Yeah, maybe they'll fix it in the Blu-ray when that comes out.
Maybe.
This is a show I would actually like go out of my way to own the disc so I could be like, oh, I have the improved version. Oh, ha, ha, ha.
I might even be there too, depending on how it continues.
Yeah.
LB, what'd you think of? Yuri skating like the delicious little pork bowl he is.
This was actually an episode where I openly admit that up until Japanese Yuri started skating, I just wasn't really into the episode all that much. I mean, I enjoyed it, but I wasn't really super into it up until Japanese Yuri started skating. And when he made his mistake and he slipped, I actually physically grimaced. Because I felt so bad for him, and I was like, oh man, he screwed it up, he's going to lose his coach, and la-da-da-da-da-da-da, that's so bad. And that's when I realized, oh, okay, maybe I'm into this more than I realize.
I've got a question. Yeah. Why did he win?
Oh, I think the juxtaposition between Yurio and Yuri is that Yurio is a better technical skater and that he's a better jumper. Which in the Olympics is all they seem to care about nowadays, but that's a whole tirade I won't go into tonight. Japanese Yuri has more finesse when it comes to like spins and step sequences and stuff like that. So if you've only watched like skating on the Olympics where all that matters is landing the jumps, then you would think that Russian Yuri won. But based on the entire quality of the performance, Yuri skating was better. At least I think that's what we were supposed to take away from it. But
Basically, Yuri's better at the performing aspect of ice skating, whereas Yurio is better at the jumps, like you said, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I just kind of watched it, and I was like, Yurio didn't mess up, the other one did. I don't really know much about skating, so I'm probably just missing what they're going for, and I guess it was.
Yeah, also, at the end of Yurio's program, do you remember when he was like, oh god, when will this program end? When will this program end?
He said that, but at the same time, it happened... Despite the fact that it happened in his head, I didn't actually see him do anything wrong. And then at the end, you have the coach to like, what's his name? Victor. Victor's all, that's your best performance ever. I'm like, okay.
Well, this could have just been me, but I think we were supposed to infer that he was getting fatigued by the end of the program. So even though he started getting a little sloppier than he otherwise would have been. But okay. Victor would have said it was his best performance because, like, Victor wants to see passion. And it probably, to his mind...
Okay, right. That does fit. That does fit the personality. I just kind of had a hard time piecing it together, I guess.
Yeah. And I'm kind of surprised there wasn't, like, a firestorm of opinion about this episode. Maybe I just haven't seen it. When Yuri was like, "Well, I can't relate to being the playboy in this program, so I'm going to portray the female." I thought there would be like a million like editorials on that. It's like, why this is the future of anime, blah blah blah. But it seems to have kind of slipped quietly under the radar. I don't know quite how that happened.
Yeah, I actually thought that was really interesting, and I'm grateful there is not a whole bunch of nonsense I need to go read and physically reel over.
Yeah, everybody just seemed to be like, "Oh, well, that's cool." Moving on. let's see, what else about this episode? Sal, anything further?
Yeah, that's it. Like, well, we're already 3 episodes in. I mean, 4 came out, but that's going to be for next week.
Yep.
And I'm sticking with it. I'm sticking with this show, you know.
You better stick with it, man.
Yeah. It's a good show.
Well, it passed the 3-episode rule. Like, it passed the test. So.
Yeah, but like once you're on the Yuri on Ice train, you don't get off. This ice train doesn't stop because it's on ice.
You mean the ice rink?
You're on the ice rink. You're like going around in circles, and you can't stop until the end of the period.
Yep, there's no gate to get out. You have to wait until it ends for the gate to magically appear.
Exactly.
Get off the ice.
Exactly. Thank you for saving my metaphor. I don't know where I was going. Okay. Anything further on about Yuri on Ice?
Not this week.
Okay, no, because we're going to move on to Izetta Episode 4, and this one, at least in terms of the discussion about it, kind of got overshadowed by the fan service, because this had, like, kind of more in-your-face fan service than the show had so far. Personally, I really didn't care, but apparently some people did. But that aside, I thought it was... Well, okay, I want to say it was interesting when they revealed, like, kind of how Izetta's witch power works and the ley lines, only I've read a urban fantasy series that's all about witches using ley lines, and it's kind of soured me on the whole concept. So it's really not Izetta's fault, but when she starts talking about, like, well, there are these things called ley lines, I'm like, God damn it! Enough with the freaking ley lines!
I see where you're coming from. At the same time, I think it's more of a way to work in the political situation that they're going for, and I think that's really what the story is going to be about. That and the relationship between the characters. More so than a story of the witch being awesome or whatever else they might do.
And also they have to give her a weakness, you know, because she was in the last few episodes, she seemed kind of overpowered in that world.
Yeah. Yeah, I was happy to see, I was happy to see an explanation. And one of the big reasons is like, now we have like this way, like they're pushing this whole science versus magic thing. And the problem with that is that magic, if you don't define it, it can just do anything. So now that they've kind of defined it, we have a way for them to sort of clash the two together.
Yeah, and I understand they needed to put some kind of limiter on Izetta, and it almost didn't matter what it was. Like, even if she was like, I can only use magic on Tuesdays and Thursdays, you know, it would just have to be something so that they need to plan around her weaknesses. LB, yeah. What did you think of this episode?
I thought I really enjoyed it. I agree with you guys that, you know, it was a good idea for them to put some kind of limit on Izetta's powers, especially after that huge battle scene in episode 3, which I know that I missed out on the chance to discuss this last time, but I'm gonna go back and just discuss this very, very, very quickly and just say that was an awesome episode 3. I really liked it. I just saw it for the first time today. End of discussion. Moving back to episode 4. Anyways. But yeah, the thing that I'm taking away, and okay, stop me if I'm totally off base here, but my spidey sense is tingling about that short-haired Bashonin who was at the end of episode 3 was asking for the testimony from the soldiers, and he was at the bedside of the fallen ruler in episode 4. My spidey sense is tingling about him. I have a bad feeling about him. Something about him is setting me off, and I think that he's going to be revealed to be something not good later on. But maybe that's just me being way off. But I just, for some reason, he sets off my spidey sense.
Lifesong, you tend to be pretty good at the spidey sense situation. So are you getting that?
I don't really, at this point, I don't really feel like I trust any of the characters aside from Izetta and the princess.
Okay, because, like, LB, I didn't notice what you were talking about, but now that you said it, I'm like, I feel like I should have, so now I'm going to be watching for that.
I feel like they haven't given us a reason to think that yet, but they also haven't given us a reason not to. I did notice that they were being, they're not doing a lot of introduction with the characters other than the princess and is that they focus really strongly on those two characters, and they really tell us very little about everyone.
It was a whole conversation with Azetta and the bodyguard that protected the princess about how that whole part that led to her kind of trusting her because of her whole story about why Azetta is loyal to the princess and stuff.
Yeah, you know, the thing is though, all these side characters that are doing any sort of like build up with, they kill them off or they throw them out. Like the two bodyguards in the beginning, they get killed. The guys that were working for the emperor that were, you know, all getting ready to drink their champagne for their victory, they got demoted and sent away. The show seems to be very good at dismissing everyone who's not the main characters.
Yeah, but for now, it looks like the bodyguard girl from episode 4, and I guess that maid might be more recurring. I mean, they appeared in the opening, so...
Yeah, I mean, they probably will be, but we've only
probably
seen them
they're
in one
probably
episode.
They're probably going to be the other major supporting cast. Hopefully it'll be paced well, because I heard that Izetta might just end after 12 episodes, like a legit ending. So
it's an anime original, I think, so yes. I assume they've got a story lined out for it.
So hopefully they have it planned out well, like pacing-wise.
Okay, just one more thing I want to bring up before we move on. I think it's interesting that Izetta is kind of knowingly kind of sacrificing herself as a piece of propaganda, basically. Like, she knows, like, she's being used in a sense, but she's okay with that because she loves Fine. But do you think she's gonna end up regretting that? Because I don't think she's going to, but I think Fine probably will.
Yeah, probably. Because remember when the flashback of her grandmother, she told her, don't ever be like the White Witch. So.
I think that's really the one compelling question. And I want to say that and make it clear. I think it's a good question, but I think that's really the one compelling question the story has going for it. And I'm very curious to see what it has to say.
You mean the question of why shouldn't she be like the White Witch?
Yeah, why shouldn't she be like the White Witch? What exactly is she going? What price is she going to pay in the process of this?
Yeah, and then the other factor too is like, the princess may be ruling the kingdom now, but there's still all those political figures that kind of try to influence her and stuff too. So they could do something too.
I don't know. I wouldn't want to be a minor political figure in that country trying to influence the princess. I don't think that would go very well. She'd just
go ahead.
She'd just be like, you do not have the best interests of my citizens at hand. You can just go away now.
I suspect that Izetta herself, there'll probably be a theme of her trying to hold on to hope as the series goes on. I think it'll probably do some darker things. I don't know how dark it'll get. I mean, we really don't know. They haven't done... Like we've been given a pretty light mood, I think, given the context of the story so far. So I don't really know what I should be expecting.
Oh yeah, and the question too is like, since they're trying to use Azetta to also get the other countries to help out, to help them against Germania, like, will she be forced to go to leave the area and go fight in the other lands too?
Yeah, I doubt that, only because of the length of the story. But we should, if they are, then we should find that out pretty quickly because.
You could say you doubt that because of the length of the story, but the thing is, they travel pretty fast in the show. Like, they travel all the way to the other ends of the country to get to, like, the old castle or whatever within one episode,
They could. And when I say travel, I don't actually mean distance. I mean, well, I partly mean distance, but I also mean, like, for the story getting from point A to point B without being completely out of whack and feeling weird.
Yeah, I mean... I could see it going both ways. I could see them staying in the country. I could see them actually, like, you know, going to Britain or whatever. Because I think on this show, it wouldn't be out of the question for them to actually travel to Britain in, like, one episode or something like that.
Also, it's interesting that Germania's leader is not Hitler in this show.
Yeah, maybe they thought it would just be laying it on a little thick to have actual Hitler.
Yeah.
So. Yeah,
well,
that would have been.
Since they did confirm it was, like, an alternate Earth, so they could do whatever they want with the setting.
Yeah, I mean, he's more of an actual emperor. It is pretty clear that that's how it's set up.
An emperor who thinks witches are cool.
I mean, they are powerful, right?
Yeah. All right, so we're going to see with Azetta where that's going. On a different note, Keijo episode 3, where we had a very, very, very serious discussion of the vacuum butt cannon. I don't know. I'm worried about Nozomi, man. I don't want her to, like, break her hips and then not be able to go pro. I was pretty absorbed in the conflict.
That's what I'm guessing. That's what I'm guessing why she's wearing that suit, that heavy swimsuit, to strengthen her body so that she can endure doing the vacuum butt cannon.
That was like Naruto ninja training.
It was. But
I think more like Dragon Ball training too. Like back to Goku training under like I think 20 times Earth's gravity and then 100 times Earth's gravity.
Yeah, I gotta say, since we just segued from Mizzetta, I think that most of these characters would actually be a pretty good match for her.
Wait, most of these characters would be a pretty good match for Mizzetta? Wait, what?
I mean, like, they probably could take out those tanks as effectively as she could, if you stop and think about the physics that are pulling off.
Oh, well...
Like breaking apart the tanks with their boobs and their butts?
Yeah!
Who knows? We'll see.
I mean, I saw someone do the math on the fan service in what was that? Zombie High School of the Dead. And so I just had me thinking of that in this episode of Keijo. I'm like, if a person could do these things, they would be devastating.
Yeah, I mean, well, I still think it's going to be a stretch if they actually pull out the Gate of Babylon I with butts. I think I might, even on this show, I might have trouble stomaching, you know, kind of buying that, but I don't know. But I am, like, genuinely invested in Nozomi. Like, I did, you know, I do want her to, you know, be a good Keijo player and whatnot. So, that's something.
I think I'm still most impressed by the quiet girl who never says anything. She's got it all figured out.
Yeah. I wonder if they're.
Oh yeah, gonna... it was kind of brand of the whole massage segment too, where she's like, yeah, while she's really good at giving massages to people, she's using it to so she knows everyone, so she can analyze everyone's body parts, so she knows how to fight them.
She knows all their weaknesses now.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's kind of creepy. I mean, ingenious, but creepy. Yeah. I wonder if we're ever going to get a flashback to Nozomi's childhood to find out why she's so obsessed with getting money in it. At any cost, and then it's gonna become like this, like Charles Dickens, like Oliver Twist sort of thing. She's like, "Mommy, can I please have more food?" No, there is no money for food. If you want food, you have to become a pro athlete.
They do have that elite classism thing going on. I don't know where they're going with that.
Do you think Nozomi's gonna get promoted to the elite class on the strength of her hips breaking the sound barrier?
Maybe. I think that if they're going to do it, they'll do it for her whole class or her whole room.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I can't see her leaving them behind for that.
But then if they get promoted, the question would be is it might be like they're trying to keep the status then.
Are they trying to what?
Like I say, if they do succeed, then the next thing might be to see like can they maintain that status?
Oh yeah, that's right. I forgot. They are doing the whole like can you rank up into the elite class thing. So that's actually like we don't even have to speculate about that. That's actually like part of the story coming up.
Yeah, it is part of the story.
Okay, so I will give. I kind of liked this episode how like seriously they took the central problem of, well, do you really want to do this move that could actually be damaging for your body? Is it really worth it to just to win? Blah 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 blah. I mean, I like it that every once in a while this show is just like plays it completely straight as a like sports anime.
Yeah, I think it's actually the appeal of the show is that it's doing that.
Yeah, that's a lot of the appeal.
Yeah,
but yeah, you got that feeling in episode one and has kept going even up to now.
Yep. Okay, so I think we're ready to move on to Flip Flappers episode 3, or I don't know what the hell's going on, but I think I like it. Yeah, so episode 3, I really don't understand any of what's happened in Flip Flappers so far, so let me just put that out there right away, but I don't know what they were even fighting in Flip Flappers episode 3. It was like this like weird girl who was like some sort of weird monster girl, but then she like maybe became a giant vagina with teeth and was trying to eat them, but then they changed into like Pretty Cure even though they were in Mad Max world and now everything is okay.
I mean she had the pure illusion. That's really all that matters.
Wait, when you say
she had the illusion fragment, whatever they call it,
do they need their illusion fragments to transform?
No, the illusion fragments, the Dr. Salt is collecting the illusion fragments in order to free Pure Illusion from inside the dream world.
Right. So every time they go into Pure Illusion and have one of these adventures, they bring back a fragment?
They're going in to get them, yeah. That's the goal of going in.
Okay, but wait. See, I saw this one like last week. Now, like right after it came out. Now I don't remember. But they discover that Kokona's friend is also part of a team that goes into Pure Illusion.
Yeah, and she's part of the team that are with the crazy dudes in the suits, evil looking suits from the end of the first episode. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh yeah, what actually happened at the end of the first episode?
We don't know. They didn't tell us, and they're still intentionally not telling us. They're just going to be getting little bits of symbolism here and there that seem intentional, but they're not meaningful yet.
Oh, life. Are they like jumping into dream world, or are they like in the world of imagination and flip flappers?
It's a little bit of both. I mean, they go into another world that they call Pure Illusion, and then when they come out, they wake up. So. I guess they're dreaming, but they don't give you an exact answer to that. Like, it's very Alice in Wonderland like. Like, they fell in a hole, I think, the first time. Is that right?
Yeah.
Actually, every time? Every single time they've fallen in a hole, actually.
All right, I wanted to ask you a question, not about this episode, actually, but episode 2. I forgot about this last week. Like, doesn't Kokona have some kind of, like, weird pet, but it's not from, like, the world of illusion? It's from, like, the real world? But it seems to be some, like, weird magical pet. But then, like, in episode 3, it's gone again? Wait, it's an actual rabbit?
Yeah, I think it was an actual rabbit. And she accidentally brought it to school. And then she went from school with it into the Pure Illusion. And it turned into, like, this badass bunny hero thing.
Bro, okay, I was really confused by that. Because, like, I didn't know if she'd actually brought, like, her pet school, or if actually, like, maybe instead of there being, like, you know, the normal world and Pure Illusion, maybe the world we think is normal in the show isn't normal either, and they have, like, magical creatures there too, and this was, like, one of those magical creatures. So I was so confused.
I think that what they're going for is it's like the world of, like, hopes and dreams and imagination, and that they're trying to bring it to life in the real world is kind of the goal of Dr. Salt. I mean, his name is Dr. Salt.
I
don't think they could lay that on any heavier.
Big Dr. Salt. That sounds like he came from a Toriyama story, since Toriyama likes to name his characters after foods.
I think the most my favorite part of the episode, actually, well, the whole episode, first of all, I thought it was awesome. I'm not entirely sure of all of what was going on in every bit of it, but you got the bit where the evil thing talks to. Oh, I'm just going to call her Blue right now because I don't remember her name. The blue one who has a normal schoolgirl life.
Kokona.
Kokona. Thank you. And she's like, "Oh, you're empty. You just did whatever you wanted to do when I put this on you. There was nothing. I didn't force you to do anything. You just." And I think the monster was actually telling her the truth. I think we were supposed to believe her.
Oh yeah, I think there is a part of her that totally resents Poppyka coming into her life and turning everything upside down. So.
Yeah, and she just wanted to hit her. And I think the real interesting moment of the whole episode is at the very end when she gets home and she sees her grandma. Well, I assume that was her grandma. And her grandma is not at all upset at her. And you kind of think she's going to be, like, she's going to have this bad family situation at home. But no, there's nothing like that at all. Her grandmother doesn't even say, "Don't be late again," or "You need to go to cram school," or anything. Just, "Next time, give me a call, please."
Yeah, so but I know you're okay. You know, the fact that scene kind of didn't go the way I was expecting makes me wonder if everything's on the up and up with the grandma. Like, maybe her grandma is, like, I don't know, a Pure Illusion person or something like that.
You know, they could be doing something like that, but they've shown us so little at this point. I kind of felt like what they were going for was sort of a reversal, like, of our expectations, where it seemed like Kokona had this pressure to be a certain way, and then you find out there's really nothing that's actually pressuring her to be the way that she is at school or going to cram school or whatnot. I guess we don't know that for sure. All we had was that one little scene. But
well, it does seem like she's kind of trying to be, like, aggressively normal. Like, maybe yes. there's something in her past. Like I mean, maybe there's a reason she ends up being Poppyka's partner in the first place. Like, maybe there's something magical in her past, and she's always been trying to, like, kind of, you know, shut that away. But we've only been given, like, tiny hints of everything.
Yeah,
so far,
we can only speculate at this point, and I think that's kind of where they're going with it. They want us to wonder what is it she needs to progress past, or what is it she's going to pull out of Pure Illusion if they do liberate Pure Illusion? You know, those kind of questions.
Yeah, and I just continue to be impressed with how, like, just visually rich and just fun to watch the show is, because it's not uncommon for a show to have a really fun, cool-looking first episode, and then as it goes along, you're like, oh, okay, they sort of used up all their good ideas on episode one there to get you hooked. But it just seems like every episode they come up with something new. And even though I was just gonna say, even though there was an obvious Mad Max influence in this episode, it was still like really. There was still a lot going on, just like the direction and just the art, and it was just really a lot to take in a good way.
Yeah, I thought actually, have they been making? Do the other two Pure Illusions? Did they have a? Did they feel like any specific story or fantasy to you?
I think. Well, I know the whole thing is kind of reminiscent of Alice in Wonderland, but.
Yes.
In the second one, where they become rabbits, I was really thinking Alice in Wonderland. But come to think of it, in the original Lewis Carroll story, I don't believe Alice ever becomes a rabbit, so I'm not sure what I was thinking of.
Well, she's chasing the rabbit, so there's still a connection there.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, I wonder if it's going to turn out that every single one of these is like loosely based on some kind of fantasy story or something.
Yeah, I mean, I could see them doing some really, like, they're making me ask really interesting questions with where they could be going. I'm just not entirely convinced that they're all a part of the story yet. I mean, I think they probably are. It feels intentional. So I'm really hyped. I'm trying not to be too hyped.
Yeah, there's like two types of anime fans this season. People who are like, oh my god, have you realized that Flip-Floppers is like the best show? Oh my god. Other people are like, I'm not even watching that. What are you talking about? Yeah. All right, so we're definitely going to keep our eyes peeled for whatever might be going on in Flip-Floppers, because hell if we know. Let's move on to something I'm not watching, Magical Girl Raising Project, Episode 4. LB and Life Song, you guys are still watching this, right?
Yep.
Are you caught up? Yep, I'm all caught up.
Okay,
oh, this episode was so good.
Why don't you start us off, Life Song, giving us your feelings on Magical Girl?
You know, I am very, very rarely... caught with something that feels like it fits in a story that comes completely out of left field when I'm just not expecting something that's going to come out of left field. And they did that in episode 4. Like, I think that surprised me. I think the way it went in episode 4 surprised me more than the death scene in episode 3 of Monoko Magica.
I can totally understand that. I mean, when Ruler, you know, bites it in this episode.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, that I did not see that coming. So yeah, that was really shocking to me.
I was actually pretty much convinced that Swim Swim was going to be death number 2.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I was like, I've seen all of this a dozen times. I know exactly where it's going. I don't really even need to think about it. This is so obvious. I'm like, holy shit, they played me really well.
Wait, who is the second death? Since I'm not watching, I don't care about being spoiled.
The really bitchy one.
The one who's talking about her subordinates all the time, and she's got the two little angels that fly around with her.
Oh, that one. She's always
yeah, really dumb. Yeah, she's the one who bites it this time.
They totally plot a coup and backstab her and kill her.
That's cool.
Was she originally seen as one of the strongest magical girls before her death?
Oh yeah.
No. Not one of the strongest. I mean, she had a ridiculous power. But we only learned what it was this episode. More that she had a team that was supporting her, and you know, at the very least, it seemed unlikely that she'd be next just because she was earning more than anyone else on her team.
I had two thoughts actually, and I'm gonna need Life's help with one of them. The first one was. Life, is it just me, or does Swim Swim give you a total Super Sonico vibe?
Oh, she totally looks like Super Sonico, and that's
okay, cool.
Almost
so it's
certainly
not
intentional.
Okay, so it wasn't just me imagining.
She's wearing
again.
Headphones and has pink hair.
Yeah, okay.
She walks around in a white swimsuit.
Okay, cool. So it's not just me. Okay, cool. The other thing is, I need some help with the timeline of this episode, because it kind of confused me a little bit. The way that I saw it play out at the end of the episode after Ruler dies, was that it's revealed that Swim Swim was the little girl who was having the bad dream that the first girl, you know, helped out before
she
died.
They actually, I mean, like, I already knew that. They revealed or very heavily hinted at that right before Nemu died.
Okay. Yeah, because that part confused me. I didn't realize that it was the same girl. So when they revealed that, it was like, wait a minute. I thought Swim Swim had been around for like a while, and was one of Ruler's followers for like a while now. And then they revealed that, oh no, she's like one of the new girls who just appeared recently, or had to have appeared recently.
Yeah, they didn't show us exactly where in the timeline she showed up, but that's not really important because it was before Snow White.
Yeah, okay. So, yeah. It just, because the way that it played out in my head was that, you know, that whole dream sequence when Nemu died happened after Snow White became a magical girl, but then I always got the impression that Swim Swim was there before Snow White. So that part really played with my head and confused me.
Oh, yeah, Swim Swim was there before Snow White. She's not, Swim Swim is not the new magical girl they've been talking about. We're probably going to meet her next week, actually.
Okay. Yeah, so, all right, I'm still a little confused, but I'll learn to cope.
I can kind of get why you're confused, because they did do a few flashbacks where it wasn't immediately clear that they were doing flashbacks in this episode. I think if you rewatch like the second half of the episode, you'll probably be like, oh, I got it.
Okay, cool. I'll go back and I'll rewatch it before I watch the next episode then, and just try to get it clear in my head. Because, yeah, it was just the way that it was presented just confused me. And
to a degree, that was probably intentional. Not necessarily confusing you, but I'm still very impressed that they actually got me with that. Like, I didn't even consider the possibility that she was going to be next.
Yeah, I didn't. I actually thought that it was going to be the nun who was going to bite it next. She seemed like the most obvious choice.
And the episode ends with the nun showing up and being like, yeah, let's form an alliance with one of the other groups of girls we met. And I'm like, they know what we're thinking. I love stories where I'm going through it and I'm like, the author is guiding me through this perfectly. I am not getting ahead of him at all. This is awesome.
Yeah. So yeah, I kind of figured that the nun was going to be the one to bite it next. So when they killed off Ruler, yeah, I'm totally with you there. That was very shocking to me. Just like, wow. Okay, I mean, did not see that coming.
I think I had a half dozen possibilities for how I thought it could play out. But she was not one of them.
Okay, so like, I need you guys to keep up with the show and just tell me who dies every week, because it's kind of fun finding out.
We can do that.
Okay. All right, so we're going to move on to something very different. March comes in like a lion. Episode 3, although we only really discussed episode 1 last time, so we can probably discuss a little bit of 2 also. I don't really know what to say about it so far, other than the fact that I like it, but it's really sad. LB, what do you think?
I'm going to warn you right now, you're going to have to cut me off at some point, because I could talk about this show for so long.
Okay.
I am so digging on this show. I am really enjoying it a lot. I'll try to keep myself, like, contained, though, and not, like, babble. For episodes 2 and 3... there were two main things that my notes centered on. The first one was the shogi aspect. Up through episodes 1 and 2, I was able to follow the shogi scenes fairly well. It wasn't until episode 3 that I really actually felt like my lack of shogi knowledge was hindering my enjoyment of the series, because episode 3 was very shogi heavy. So, you know, I felt like, you know, okay, you know, maybe I need to learn a little bit more about this game so I can figure out why this is so incredibly dramatic. So that was the first time that I felt like my lack of knowledge about this game was really playing against me.
Have you ever played, like, chess or any of those other types of strategy?
Yeah, I've played chess. I'm not any good at it, but...
I actually forgot about March Comes In Like a Lion. I'm discombobulated from our awkward schedule. I think that a lot of those strategy games, like, if you really try to get into one a little bit, you wind up finding out, oh, this is actually really exhausting.
Yeah, totally. yeah, the other thing that I took away from these two episodes was I loved the character development over these two episodes. I really felt like I got to know these characters so much better. Like, Akari especially, I totally did not expect for them to reveal, oh, at, you know, at night she works as a hostess in a bar. You know, I, for such a motherly type character, that didn't, that, you know, that caught me off guard. I didn't see that coming.
I'm so glad that she's not dying of a mystery disease. You're lying, April, had enough of that for me.
No, it's, she works, she makes ends meet by working as a hostess. And she's very good at it, and then she comes home and she acts very motherly towards her siblings and everything, and it's very good.
Right. Well, I was, but my big question when I was watching the first episode was, okay, how does he know these three girls? Are they, like, distant cousins of his or something? Or, like, friend of a friend? It wasn't clear. And then you find out, in either the second or the third episode that, oh, he actually, she just, like, started looking after him one time when he got drunk. Like, he actually doesn't have any sort of formal relationship other than she was like, oh, I'm worried about you, I'll take care of you. So.
Yeah, totally. Which, you know, that plays into the whole motherly aspect, which, you know, I even have a note in my bar that I kind of wish I had someone like Akari in my life, just a motherly type character who's not, like, super older than me, but, you know, a little bit older than me, who would be just, like, that kind of caring individual. You know, that'd be really, that, you know, that's something that everybody should have in their life.
Yeah, see, I think I was thinking, can I be more caring and nurturing to my family, like the way Akari is? Can I be a better mother? So, yeah, this show is just hitting us where we live, apparently. I mean, I'm just still not quite sure. I don't want to say I don't know what the show's about, because, you know, it's about these characters. It's a character study of Ray and, you know, these other people in his life. And obviously they've had some tragedy in their life and he's had tragedy in his life, and it's how they, like, comfort each other. So, like, you know, I think that's plenty for the show to be about. I just feel like I'm kind of missing a piece of the puzzle. You know, does that make any sense?
It does. I don't think that they've given you that piece of the puzzle yet anyway. So yeah, if you're missing it, it's because they haven't presented it to you.
I will say that that first of all, it feels almost the theme feels almost identical to me of Your Lie in April. Just instead of pianos, you've got shogi. So they'll, I think, LB, have you seen that?
Yeah. Yeah, I have.
Does that seem like an accurate statement to you?
Not yet. No one is appearing to be dying yet.
Well, I mean, no, I don't mean about the dying, but in Your Lie in April, the theme is kind of in the face of all the trauma, persevering. That was really the message I thought I took away from it anyway.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I totally agree with you on that message. I don't know if I see that message in this series.
Yeah, I'm not sure either. Okay.
You know, it's, I think it's hinting towards that, but right now it's still building the character.
The thing is with Your Lie in April, and I kind of hope they do take it in a different direction, but even if they don't, it might be interesting. But the reason I see that vibe is because in the first episode, it feels a lot like where Your Lie in April started, minus the obvious romance angle, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. Your Lie in April took, like, what, 8-10 episodes before it really let us
about
know?
It. Yeah, about eight episodes, I'd say, before it really started to hint at, you know, what it was really about and where it was going to go. This series, you know, one thing in particular, I'm glad you brought up the romance angle, because I'm really glad that they haven't introduced any kind of romance angle yet. I think that would have been a bad choice. And I'm really glad that this series is staying away from that so far.
They're not going there with the second sister.
No, they're not that okay. I'm aware of. Not that I've seen, at least. I mean, in episode 3, there's a really sweet scene where the second sister, Hina, walks away and goes to the waterfront so that she can have a cry by herself because she's, you know, sad about her mother. And he and Ray follows her and, you know, kind of comforts her a little bit eventually. Which I thought was a great scene. I admit it made me misty-eyed. You know, so that was really great, but But overall, everything is strictly platonic, which I'm really glad about, and I think it show. I think it's really nice to show that you can have familiar, you can have family bonds with non-family members, and have it just be platonic without having to introduce some kind of romantic trap somewhere along the way. By the way, if you're hearing something in the background, that's my dog eating her food. I wasn't sure if the mic was picking that up.
Very, very lightly.
Oh, okay. I don't really feel it, so it's all good.
Okay, all right. Sorry.
Oh man, I had a thought about March comes in like a lion, and then like you talked about your dog, and now I'm just thinking about how I want to adopt a cat, but Wilson doesn't want one. Damn it. about the romance. Things could change going forward, but I don't feel romance would be appropriate on this show right now. And, you know, I think sometimes when characters have problems, it's kind of like, oh, well, what if he or she falls in love? That would solve everything. Blah, blah. And, you know, sometimes that is true. Sometimes what someone is missing in life is a partner. But, you know, it's not always that simple. There could be a lot more. There are a lot of different ways for things to go down. So it's nice to see that they don't always go to the romance well, I guess, to solve problems. So, okay, I think that sounded smarter in my head because it seemed to become more and more insipid the more I talked about it. But let's just pretend it was smart and we'll move on. Okay, we could probably just kind of quell about March comes in like a lion for a while. We should probably move on, right? Yeah.
All right.
LB is like, well, I still have 34 pages of notes, but if you insist. Okay, moving on to Kiss Him, Not Me, episode 3. I just have a bias against cultural festivals, like an anime about cultural festivals. Like, I feel like if I can't go there and eat the takoyaki, I don't want to see it anymore. But but it was still a cute episode that continues to hold my attention.
Don't they have something like that in New York? Like a New York equivalent of the cultural festival where you could eat that stuff?
Huh?
They have those pretty much in every major city.
So I was curious if there is something like an event like that.
Oh, I'm sure they have some kind of. I mean, we had on Long Island, we have the Oyster Festival every year, which I would have gone to if there weren't friggin' like 20,000 other people there. But yeah, I mean, the high school cultural festival is like a trope I'm kind of tired of.
Oh, okay.
What'd you think of this one, LB?
I was actually really kind of shocked with all the different directions that they went with this series. I mean, I had a feeling that Mitsumi was going to be the first to back off from the whole harem thing. I didn't expect for everyone to suddenly back off at once and then suddenly decide, oh, I got an idea. Let's just divvy her up. You know, it's like, really? That's your solution? You're going to just divide her up and it's going to be all good. So I thought that was really interesting. There was one part that I was kind of sad about. I was really sad that they resorted to the face and the breast joke. I thought that was just stupid and didn't need to be there.
Yeah, you know, I think I had almost blocked out that even happened until you mentioned it.
Yeah, it happened. You know, if I have to remember it, you have to remember it.
I can't get away with anything around here. yeah, no, I thought the way they were kind of like, okay, well, I'll get her for 15 minutes and then you get her for 15 minutes. Like, I think there's part of you as a viewer that wants to yell at her. You can just say no, Kai. You can be like, no, I don't want to date you all like that. But the thing is, like, again, going back to feeling like I've been in her position, like, it wouldn't occur to her to say no because she's so flattered, uh-huh. You know?
Yeah.
So she doesn't realize that saying no is an option, which you can rant about how well she should realize it, but that is realistic to me. So
yeah, totally.
But now they've kind of like addressed the fact that they're all kind of hanging out as a group now with I should get to know names by this point, but the one who's kind of like the most chill of the guys and the one who liked her from the beginning, he's like, I just like hanging out with you guys. This is cool. So he's just like along for the ride, and I'm not sure how much the rest of them are going to kind of enjoy going around as a group of five, but we shall see. I don't know. I feel like as much as I'm enjoying this series, I don't really have a whole lot to say, probably because of the cultural festival bias. Enough with the cultural festivals.
I was going to say, the only way they'll disappear is if prom disappears from Western high school shows.
Yeah, you're right. It's never going to happen. Look, I'm just saying, if I have to keep watching all these like cultural festivals and like 10 million yeah. different anime. Someone can just like FedEx me some fresh takoyaki. I mean, I don't really think that's.
Do you really want to eat takoyaki that's been in a FedEx box?
Oh, shoot. No, I don't. I need to go to Japan and get takoyaki.
Oh, or you could order a takoyaki maker from J-List and learn how to make them yourself.
I would get that and I'd be like, this is so cool. And then I'd never use it. It would suffer the fate of 99% of all kitchen appliances. I don't know. Someday I'll get to have takoyaki. Okay, moving on to shows.
I will, before we move on, though, I do have to say, though, that I loved some of the one-liners in this episode. I loved her just screaming out that life is nothing but a shitty game.
Isn't that an homage to, speaking of something we mentioned before, The World God Only Knows?
I don't know.
Oh, that's been said long before The World God Only Knows.
Yeah, all right.
What was the first anime that said '90s at the earliest?
Yeah, well, I didn't think like that show had like invented the line or anything, but like I it was kind of the tagline for The World God Only Knows. But yeah, they could have been riffing on several different things there, I suppose.
Yeah, I saw that line and I laughed. I screen capped it and kind of moved on from there. But yeah, I think the biggest strength of this particular episode was that it just had some really good one-liners.
Yeah. All right, so moving on to the other show that only LB and I are watching, because we're the only ones with proper taste. Utsa no Prince Sama, Legend Star, episode 4. I was actually really, really bored with this episode until they got to, like, the ultimate ninja warrior part. And then they started, like, having a fist fight, and then they, like, knocked each other out and started hallucinating that they were fist fighting in space. And then I was like, this episode is okay. I'm okay with this turn of events. But to the beginning, I was just, this is a really boring season of Utapri, in my opinion. I'm not saying the others have been, like, that interesting, but this one I'm just finding pretty dull, except when they're, like, doing something completely ridiculous. Did you like this episode more than me?
I'd like to, go back and revise something that I said a couple of weeks ago. You asked me when the season first started who my favorite Utapri was, and I said Ren. But then I watched this episode and I forgot how much I love CO when he gets fired up about something. When the little guy gets fired up, he's awesome. I love watching him when he's all like fired and pumped up and everything.
Yeah, you know, like I want him to like be my life coach. I want him to come and like get me pumped up whenever I need to do anything I don't want to do. I'd just like, he'd be like, no, well, Karen, the reason why you have to do this is blah, and it's to bring a smile to everyone in the world that you do this. I'm like, yes, yo, I'll go do this right now. Yeah, he is pretty cool.
So it looks like you two are on the same page on who the best Utapri guy is.
Oh, no. Don't get me wrong. I like Sio. I want him to be my life coach. I don't want him to be my, paramour. That's still
yeah. I mean, Sio is awesome, and I totally relate to him. You know, being the little guy, always having to prove himself, because you know I am a little guy. I am a very, very little guy, but that's another point. Anyways, but yeah, Ren is still probably my overall favorite. But Sio, when he gets all pumped up and like all fired up and energetic about something, he's just so much fun to watch.
Yeah, well, come to think of it, I'm looking forward to Ren's duet episode because, like, just, I don't even remember who Ren's paired with, but I hope Ren is just, like, all, like, I'm gonna sit here and play my saxophone and look sexy while the other guy is, like, freaking out about the duet or something like that.
Yeah. the other things that I had to mention about the show was just, overall, this was actually kind of a ridiculous episode in terms of, like, the whole competition, because I remember when the competition first started, the announcers, like, oh, we're going to have this competition all the way up until the full moon and all the way to the end of the episode. They are under sunlight. And it's like, you were off there, buddy. So that was the first thing that kind of got me. And then the whole, I totally agree with you about the fight scene when they're having the fist fight, and they're like, once they start singing about the fight and they're like in space and reaching out for the older brother, and like they're like having this weird, you know, Pink Floyd hallucination, It was just like, oh my god. I was like face palming and shaking my head, but I was still laughing and just enjoying it. You know, so it was so campy, but honestly, it's Oedipree, so I knew. So if you're up to season 4 of Oedipree and you're not expecting campy by now, you are so like off in left field without a clue.
I want to meet that person. I want to meet that person who's up to season 4 of the show who's sitting here like, this is not the very reasoned, you know, introspective idol drama I was looking for from the show. It's like, there's got to be a person out there like that.
People are still making that comment about Symphogear, so I'm sure there's someone out there making it about Oedipree.
Wait, what's the Symphogear comment life?
that it's actually like this. Intellectual. I don't even know. The comments don't make any sense. I just come across a couple of them where people are like, "This is commentary and such and such." No, it's most certainly not.
Was Symphogear the one with where they had the maids who were like special forces?
No.
Symphogear is the one where they kung fu fight while they're singing idol songs that have magical powers.
Basically, the
and they and they're all in mecha suits. It's ridiculous.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, and Satellite was involved in it, too, if I remember correctly, right?
Yeah
it's so. Getting a season 4. It's really popular with a certain subset of anime fans, which happened to be a part, but it's most certainly not deep in any way.
Okay. I don't know. From what I've seen of it, I just thought it was just ridiculous, over-the-top fun.
Yep.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. I've only watched a couple of episodes of the first season, but yeah, that's totally off topic, so we'll save that for another time.
Okay, Symphogear, some other time, that is not now. Okay, moving on to Drifters Episode 3, again, show I am not watching. Lifesong, what do you think of Drifters 3?
But before we get to Drifters, I have a comment. I need to correct myself on something I said earlier. I said a couple times on the podcast because I just realized I'm wrong. Mm-hmm. March Comes in Like a Lion, the original, was not written by the author of
Your Lie in April.
Your Lie in April. Yeah, it was actually the author of Honey and Clover. I don't know how I got this mixed up. I was trying to figure it out. Can't figure it out.
Oh, I know why. Because the wording, Your Lie in April, March Comes Like a Lion.
It's like a little, I don't know. I have no idea. Season. Anyway, Drifters. Hannibal Pete himself, a fighter pilot from World War, a Japanese fighter pilot from World War II, flew out to the middle of a battle like that looked like the battle from Lord of the Rings, and he started shooting down dragons. Billy the Kid, he's a good guy. What am I even watching? I don't even know. It's awesome, but I have no idea.
LB, you're keeping up with this one, right?
Yeah, I am. This episode was just a total wash for me. Even the fighter pilot taking down dragons couldn't save this episode for me. The reason why, and I know exactly the reason why, is because I'm not enough of a history buff. So this entire episode was just nonstop violence with people that I didn't recognize. They weren't named. They weren't labeled. So, you know, I was just having a really hard time getting into it. It was just random people. I actually had to have people explain to me, oh, this is who this person was. This is who this person was.
I didn't know who all of them were. I still don't know who the Japanese fighter pilot was. I will have to.
He was actually the most decorated World War II fighter pilot. His nickname was Kano the Destroyer, I believe. And he disappeared in action and was presumed dead at some point. It's something Kano. But yeah, that's who he was.
Okay. Yeah. I thought that was interesting. I think I knew everyone else. So I didn't
immediately pick up on who everybody was.
I think one of them they never told us, but everyone they told us, I think I was like, oh, I know who that is.
Yeah. So, you know, I was lost, and I just didn't.
We even had Anastasia show up, and she's freezing people to death, because, some of them are evil, by the way.
Some of them are evil. Actually, from what I understand, the one who was... No, wait, not the one who was freezing people. Sorry, I was thinking of the one who was burning people.
Yeah, that was Joan of Arc.
Yeah, that was Joan of Arc. Sorry, I was getting... They threw out so many characters in this episode.
I think that minion that follows her around is Giles, which is really weird to me after. Like, the Giles in Fate Zero is always going to be the official anime Giles in my mind.
Yeah. I mean, he was awesome.
Okay, just from listening to you two talk about the show, it kind of sounds like Fate Stay Night with attention deficit disorder.
Sort of. With violence turned up to 11.
I know that you won't get this, but it feels like Fate Stay Night written by the author of Hellsing.
Mm.
I guess the only difference is that the people, the historical people, are still alive. No.
They might be in like some kind of hell.
They're like in an alternative universe. I don't know if that qualifies them as still being alive, but they aren't dead either. Yeah. So,
like in fighting wars of purgatory in the purgatory of Middle Earth, or something like that. I'm like, really? It was like, what was it? They didn't give the guy a name, but like, Sauron shows up in this episode with his army.
Actually, according to my friends, that's Jesus.
Oh!
What? Oh my god! Like, Jesus actually appears in this story?
Dude! I knew this was a heaven and hell thing. I do it.
You know what's great to me? The second coming happened, Lysong didn't notice.
There's no way they haven't told us anything about who this guy is.
Yeah, I was having my friends explain it to me afterwards, and they were like, oh yeah, as soon as we saw the holes in his hands, we knew that it was Jesus. And how did I miss that?
Did your friends also read the manga? Because
no, they're just big history buffs, and they just picked it up just by watching.
I completely missed the holes in his hands. I don't know how I missed that. I'm gonna have to go back and see that.
Yeah.
Because I was examining him, like, who the hell is this guy?
All right, well, you guys are gonna have to keep me appraised of what Jesus does in Drifters, because now I'm kind of curious. Let me know if Moses drops by anytime.
Well, at least Jesus will have an infinite supply of wine of all that blood that's being spilled.
Doesn't he turn water into wine?
Oh, it was water.
I'm Jewish, so this is all just very confusing to me. Anyway, okay.
It's really ridiculous.
What?
Utterly ridiculous.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to move on to some shorts. Kaiju Girls, Episode 5, and Sal. When am I going to get a big Kaiju Girls fight? Huh? When's it going to happen?
I'm hoping soon, because they are hinting of the rogue Kaiju Girls, if they're going to do anything with that, and then the professional Kaiju Girl fight, so...
It's just like, I mean, it's cool that they can all transform now, but they're just kind of like hanging out and like, I don't know, talking. I want to see my kaiju girls do some proper kaiju stuff. And one more thing I wanted to mention, it bothers me that when they do their transformation sequences, they actually like go to full proportions before they go back to chibi. I want even the transformations to be chibi. That would make me happy.
Yes.
We're on the same page there?
Yeah, I'm guessing that the full body is either because that's how they looked in the light novels, or it's to market the figures even more.
Yeah, everything should be chibi. Everything. Imagine how cute Marsh comes in like a lion would be if everybody was chibi.
Also, like, the transformation would be adorable if they're like 100% chibi.
Yeah. Oh, well. Okay, time to talk about something I've been waiting to talk about for a couple of weeks. Gakuen Handsome. Finally, someone watched it. Yay! Lifesong took the plunge. Doesn't this just have the most awe-inspiring animation you've ever seen?
Oh, yeah. I don't think I've ever seen quality on this level before.
It's just like, okay, I know it's intentionally bad, but at the same time, it's like...
It's actually bad.
Like, yeah, right, exactly. Like, usually when it's intentionally bad, like, it's still, like, kind of good. Like,
yeah, it's like you'd think, okay, well... Is this really some guys getting together just making, like, the junkiest show they can just to see if people will watch it and pay them?
I guess so. But I know you've only watched the first episode, but if you persevere to episode 4, there's it's funny at the end.
there's a moment that's funny. Okay, I think I can make it there. They're only 3 minutes long.
Yeah. Like, I guess this is a parody of, you know, like, Bishonen shows, but like there's no girl in it. So, well, there is a girl, but she's just like the one little girl. So,
well, I mean, she's the one little girl who got like 3 school confessions, and her brother's just like, I don't care, I'm completely ignoring you.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Apparently, Gakuen Handsome was actually a visual novel game.
Seriously? Yeah. Was it a visual novel with equally bad art?
Yes, the art was just bad. Like it's weird. I'm looking at screenshots. There's both art of characters that look normal looking, and then there's the badly the character you see in Gaku and Handsome with the stretched out faces.
I need to find out more about this.
I had heard the name before, and I guess that's why.
Oh, what life?
Last week I was thinking, didn't this already get an anime before or something? And I guess that I remembered it existing, and I wasn't sure why. And now that I'm looking at the page for the light novel, or for the visual novel, I'm like, oh yeah, I have seen of this before.
Okay, well, you should keep up with it, because I know I'm going to watch it all the way through, so.
Well, at 3 minutes an episode, I think I can manage.
Oh, I made Wilson watch one episode of it, and he just gave me a look like, that's 3 minutes of my life I'll never get back. Okay, so that was everything I had on my list. I'm watching some other shows, but that I really have nothing to say about at this point. Like, I'm watching Wagnaria, nothing to say. Stella no Maho, it's fun, but really nothing to say. So that's really all I have to talk about. Anyone else want to bring up anything before we sign off?
Is anybody else watching any of the new dubbed shows that Funimation is now simuldubbing? Their season has officially started.
I haven't yet.
I checked out the first episodes of Yuri on Ice and 91 Days. I don't really have much to say about Yuri on Ice. The dub is passable. It's fine. 91 Days. If any of you want to check it out, the dub is actually really pretty good. They are giving it the Bakano treatment. They're playing,
yes!
Yeah, nice! They're playing up the accents and
good!
Everything.
Good!
Well, I will never be as excited about anything as I think Sal was just excited.
Yeah, I did not expect that.
I just love that Bakano dub was just so awesome. It's like, and I'm happy they went with that, because we were talking about that on Discord earlier about the dub, that they're going to dub it. They have to go all Bakano with it.
Yeah, I mean, to be fair, Bakano has had a lighter tone to it overall. So, I mean, they're not, like, totally playing up, like, humor aspects. But, I mean, they're giving it to Bakano treatment in regards to their, you know, playing up the accents. They're really making it feel like a genuine mafia story. And they're really playing up the tone of the time period, so that's what I mean when they're giving it the Bakano treatment. So I'm really glad that they are. If you get a chance, it's worth checking out the first episode. The first episode went up just a couple of days ago. I'll be sticking with it, so you know.
Okay, well, I didn't end up watching that show when it aired, I think, last season in Japanese, so I might catch it dubbed.
I guess if I don't get to watch it, I guess I'll wait to see what you think about the show overall, and then I'll probably try to get it on Blu-ray when they release it.
Okay, that sounds good. Yeah, I mean, like I said, I've only seen the first episode, but I don't see any reason why I'm going to drop it so far. Maybe that'll change in a couple of weeks, but right now, you know, this is a show that I've been really looking forward to. First episode didn't disappoint. The dub is more than passable, you know, so, you know, I think that this is going to be a show that I'm going to be checking out. I might try and convince my wife to check it out with me as well.
Okay, cool. Isn't it nice when you can get your spouse to watch anime with you?
Yeah, the problem is that she doesn't really like watching shows weekly. She prefers to marathon. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I might have to twist her arm a little bit, but it's like, this is a bloody mafia revenge story. How are you not, you know, this should hit all of your buttons.
Ooh, like, did your wife enjoy Bakano?
She did enjoy Bakano.
Okay, cool. So I think we are done for this week, right?
I got one.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Go ahead.
Occultic 9, I'm keeping up with that. Episode 3 really pulled it all back together in a I need to watch this show kind of way. I don't know. You know how we were talking about Flip Flappers last week and how it has this sort of sense of adventure to it, where there's always something going on that makes you really kind of, it inspires a sense of wonder. Not to the same degree, but Occultic 9 is starting to kind of fit in there and pull that off in a Durarara Bakano type of way. But I don't know. I'm starting to really like what they're doing with it.
I'm getting tempted to watch it again. Watching too much anime.
Yeah, I mean, this is obviously the end of the introduction to the series too. So we'll see where it's going after this. Like, the first episode starts with this crazy scene where all these corpses are in like some park, and the end of the third episode, we're back to the corpses in the park. And this kind of, yeah, okay, now we've been introduced to the cast. We've got a pretty good idea of who everyone is, how they relate to each other, what the themes of the story are. I'm like, they successfully establish a whole lot in those three episodes, and there's still a lot going on. Like, there's this crazy mystery with this guy, the main character. I don't know if he's even the main character. There's so many characters, but the first main character we're introduced to is going insane with paranoia at this point, thinking he's going to get stuck being framed for murder, and every other character in the show trying to decide whether supernatural stuff exists or doesn't exist.